In this video lecture, we're going to take a look at using multiple methods together in one program. We'll also take a look at a practical example of revising a sequential execution program into such a program organization. Okay, let's get started. So just as a refresher on prior lecture materials, why do we want to use methods in the first place? Methods are useful in programs for several reasons. They allow us to group together multiple related operations into one named, reusable set of statements, which we can execute as a whole using that one name. They allow us to separate the aspects of some code which are the same each time from the aspects which differ each time. The parts which are the same for any data become the body of the method, and the data which differs each time becomes the input to the method. Finally, methods allow us to structure our programs better by burying away all the computational details into some lower level methods. In general, if we find ourselves doing something more than once or twice in a program, we really ought to consider restructuring our program a bit to make use of methods. In the material which follows, let's consider two different ways of implementing a solution to the following problem. Let's consider the following very simple and somewhat artificial problem statement. Write a program to convert miles to yards and acres to square feet. Prompt the user for inputs and display the results. For our purposes, assume whole numbered inputs and treat any conversion factors as defined constants. Now, this is an intentionally simplistic problem, and the part about restricting ourselves to whole numbered inputs does seem a little unrealistic. But all this is done just for purposes of demonstration. So just kind of work with me here, please. What we want to do is show how to implement this problem in two different ways. An okay way, using straight sequential code, and a better way, using multiple methods within the same file. By the way, these examples will be a notable exception to our normal practices, in that the code will be shown but not provided as source code in the lecture module. I will, however, provide it in PDF form. I'm doing it this way because you'll likely be creating something similar in an upcoming assignment, and I want you to have the experience of implementing it from scratch using methods, rather than simply downloading the code and adapting it. But you can still refer to the following examples as a guide, and I hope you'll do so. So, moving on. This code on the right is one perfectly acceptable problem solution, structured in a standard way which should already be somewhat familiar. Up here at the top, we declare all our variables, including two scanner objects for user input. We set up our conversion constants. And for each of the problems we want to solve, we prompt for user inputs. We perform the needed conversion calculations. And we display some formatted before and after results. We set this last part of the program up in the way we do so that we see the results of our conversion as soon as we enter each input. Down here on the right, we see our program's output for two simple values, and I've intentionally chosen one for both the inputs just to check the conversion numerics, and it all seems correct versus these conversion factors up here. So this is a perfectly acceptable code implementation, and we see that it gives correct results. However, notice that it's in the form of one big long set of sequential code statements. There is the one required main method up here, and there is a straight line path of execution from top to bottom, one statement after another. As we'll see in a moment, there are several operations which are duplicated, except using different data each time. So while this code works just fine, it just seems kind of busy and visually dense. And so the logical question might be, can we improve upon this? I think you can guess the answer to that already, right? As a starting point toward improving our code, we might want to step back and look for commonality or repeated operations in it. Here on the right, I've marked up the program using some color coding to identify common operations. For starters, notice that both of these scanner declarations are identical, and we really don't need two of them. We can use one single scanner object for all our input needs. We do not need dedicated ones for each input. Next, note that these two user input statements in red, here and here, are similar for both inputs. As shown by the highlighted portions, in each case, we print a user prompt using system.out.print for a same line input prompt, and then we use scanner's next int to read the next int input. The only thing that changes is this prompt text in green. In both cases, scanner has no idea why it's reading an int value. The user is just shown a prompt, and scanner reads one int value, regardless of its intended purpose. Now, these calculations in between are indeed distinct, but the constants from up above they use only pertain to one or the other operation. Finally, these output statements in blue, which you might or might not be able to discern, are also similar. In both cases, these highlighted portions are identical. We use system.out.println to print an output, and the first part of it is what we'll call the formatting, this little arrow thingy to call attention to the output. The only thing that changes is the text after the arrow that gets printed. Once again, each print command doesn't know what it's being asked to print or why. It's just given some text and it obediently displays it to the screen. So overall, what we want to do here is turn the repeated sections of code into more generic, reusable methods. Remember that we said earlier, if we do something more than once or twice, our code might be improved by turning the repeated operations into methods, which is just what we're going to do next. Here's a revised design for our program. Recall from an earlier lecture, we called these black box models. As we see here on the right, we still have the required main method, but now we've compartmentalized the repeated operations into four dedicated helper methods, as we see here below. This structure reflects our revised new program structure in our updated .java source code file. The main method at the top is still the starting point of our program, but now all it does is declare any needed data, and then it uses or calls the other methods to offload the computational work. This next input method is what we'll use to obtain any user input int values. We'll input some prompt text as a string, and then internally, the method will set up a scanner, display the prompt text, and then read and return a generic int value. By generic, what we mean is we can use this to obtain any int value. This method has no idea why it's reading an int. It's just asking for whatever it was told to ask for, reading it, and then returning it. These next two methods are for the individual conversions. Each one accepts one input value, performs the indicated conversion, and returns that value to the caller. The nice thing here is that the two conversion constants are both localized to where they're needed. Finally, this last one represents a generic display method. All it's doing is accepting some specified text string and printing it out in some formatted way. For now, we're just printing the text after some display arrow, but we could get more elaborate with it if we wanted. All the formatting is isolated inside this method. Also, notice that this method accepts one string input and simply prints it, so it returns no value, and thus it's a void type method. The advantages of this revised structure are threefold. It results in a leaner, cleaner, simpler main method. These four helper methods can possibly be reused in other code, and all the computational details are hidden away or isolated into these individual dedicated four methods. As we'll see in a moment, restructuring our sequential program into a more method-based structure like this, or better yet, designing it like this in the first place, leads us to much better, more readable, more maintainable code. Here's another conceptual take on our restructured program. Now our top-level main method becomes very lean and focused, with all the underlying details hidden away in these other methods. It's sort of like this iceberg shown on the right. The main method, the proverbial tip of the iceberg, is all we can see, but most of the guts of the program are hidden from view under the surface. I honestly didn't think about it when I was preparing this diagram on the left, but its colorizations are a very fortunate coincidence, as the main represents the part where the sun is shining, and the blue represents the portions that are hidden away in the water. Pretty nice, huh? As we'll also see beginning soon, these diagrams also represent the typical paradigm of object-oriented programming, some small visible object with lots of capability available underneath the surface. When all is finally said and done, these left and right sides show our earlier program revised into a more method-based solution. This new version is now named MultipleCalcsMethods.java, and it will be made available in PDF format only, but not as source code. For a current assignment, I don't want you simply copying and adapting this code. I want you to write it from scratch, but patterned after this example. On the left here, we see the revised main method, which I think you'll agree is now much more compact and easier to follow. All we're doing here now is declaring the same four needed variables, then making a chain series of method calls to perform and display each conversion. Notice that we're using the same input method for both conversions, just prompting for different values. Also, notice how the outputs of these first input methods become the inputs to the second conversion methods. Finally, we use the same display method in both cases, and we incorporate both the before and after converted values within the text which is to be displayed. As a reminder, this appending of smaller strings and values into a larger string is called string concatenation. On the right, we now see how the four helper methods hide away all the code details. Each of these methods is short and sweet, to the point, and performs one specific action. By the way, notice this good coding convention of preceding each method with a one-line comment describing it, which is what I'll also expect your code to do as well now on. Also, note how all the methods on both sides have descriptive verb-leading names by good convention, which I'll also expect to see in your code. Now we have the scanner setup localized within this input method, and by the way, these step numbers 2 to 4 reference an existing app note, with step 1 being up here outside the class definition. We also have the two conversion constants localized to the methods in which they're used, and both these methods are simply multiplying an input by a conversion factor and simply returning the result. Finally, in this output method, our formatting is simply printing this arrow output, as we see down here in the output, but we could make this more elaborate if we wanted to. For example, we might decide we want to print all the outputs inside of some type of visual box or something. The important thing to understand is that this input method and this output method are now fully generic. The input method has no idea of what its input data purpose is. It's just being told to return an int value given some prompt text. The output method has no idea as to what the purpose of its output message. It's just being told to display some text and format it somehow. In other words, these two methods are now fully general and could be reused anywhere else to obtain external int input or to display formatted output text. As a matter of fact, the two conversion methods could also be reused as well. And finally, in case you were wondering, this output shown on the bottom right is exactly the same as before. In summary, here are the two program versions one last time, side by side. Original sequential style on the left, revised method organized style on the right. Although the original version may be a little shorter, the revised version is a better structured, cleaner, and more reusable program, with the details hidden away inside the individual methods. This is the type of code structure you probably want to use when you have repeated operations. Just be careful not to over-apply it all the time, because in other situations, this left type of sequential code is perfectly fine. In fact, many of our recent and coming programs will be just fine in this style. But this code on the right is the kind of method-organized code you'll be asked to write in a current program assignment illustrating methods. So use this example as a guide. Furthermore, this is more the program style we'll ultimately be aiming for when we begin writing our own user-defined Java classes. Okay, and with that, I think we are done with this example demonstrating multiple methods in a program.